Psalm 4. Answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart his faithful servant for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Tremble and do not sin. When you are on your beds, search your hearts and be silent. Offer the sacrifices of the righteous and trust in the Lord. Many, Lord, are asking, who will bring us prosperity? Let the light of your face shine on us. Fill my heart with joy when their grain and new wine abound. In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety.
Cum invocarem, a response to Psalm 4. Till troubles cease and only joys remain, take refuge in the shelter of his love, who hears your call and feels with you your pain, who does not keep his distance high above, but brings his light into your little room, nestles and settles with you like the dove in its familiar dovecot. From the womb of Mary to her house in Nazareth, from the upper chamber to the empty tomb, he comes to share with you your every breath and to commune with you. To every heart that opens to him, he will bring new birth, for every ending offer a new start. Lie down in peace and trust and take your rest, safe in the love of one who'll never part.
Come, thou before it, God, Our reading today is from Acts. Acts 2 verses 1 to 21. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and come to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues, and the Spirit enabled them. Now, they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in the native language? Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Perlia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Crete, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we heard them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up, the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I have to say. Those people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, that is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God said, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. Blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
It's really good to be with you all on the birthday of the church, this Pentecost Sunday. And first, I want to thank you for all that you're doing personally and as church communities at this extraordinary and demanding time, especially for those isolated, vulnerable, and in particular need amongst us. It's so great to be part of a diocesan family where churches are making a real difference to their communities, on and offline, as it were. I'm also conscious too of many personal challenges amongst us, anxieties and fears about the future. Please be reminded today that the God of Pentecost is with us by his Holy Spirit and in us, and we need to continue to be patient together in the remaining journey through and out of lockdown. Trust seems to be the big issue of the moment. After all that has happened earlier this week in government and the media over the Dominic Cummings issue, the question is out there. Who can we trust in this crisis? And more, why should we trust them? You will not be surprised by my answer. Most of you know the story of the first Pentecost so well. It's festival time in Jerusalem, and the disciples are all together, as the scripture says, in one place, awaiting the promise of Jesus. The Holy Spirit comes in wind and fire. They break out and speak and tell of the good news of Jesus' death and mighty resurrection. Then we read this. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" There is a stark and challenging parallel here to our current situation. Like Jesus' first disciples, we are all together in one place, maybe not physically, yet we are in this lockdown together, even if some of us are able to go out to work and to minister. We are in it all together. And soon we'll begin to emerge all together, step by step, into a new world, a new normal. And that same question of the people of Jerusalem in that passage hangs in the air. What does this mean? Or if you like, can we trust these crazy people who seem to have a message for us? Or are they drunk? Or what? Peter stands up and explains to them in their own Jewish religious context, quoting the prophet Joel, that this is what God has promised them all along, an outpouring of the Spirit on all people. And more than that, it is because of Jesus, who was crucified just a few days before and is now risen from the dead. Whatever our situation and anxieties about the future, we can and we must trust the Lord Jesus Christ, risen from the dead. He is the answer to the question and the reason for our trust. Some of you have heard me tell this story before, but when I was a vicar in Nottingham, there was a wayside pulpit outside a Baptist church on one of the main highways. And using the words of the famous Simon and Garfunkel song, one of the posters said this: "God does not give us a bridge over troubled water, but a pathway through it." And that same Jesus leads us on that pathway, not above the trouble, but through it, as we begin to emerge. The risen Jesus gives us his Spirit afresh today, this Pentecost Sunday. He is in us and walks before us through this dark valley of the virus into the future. We can trust him above all else. That is what this means. And with that assurance comes the challenge to us as his modern disciples and messengers. What do we say to the people out there in our parishes and communities as they ask, what does this mean? Can we trust this God of yours? You see the parallel with the first disciples. Lockdown, emergence, communication in response to the questions of meaning out there in the world. We're in this together. And as we emerge, we get a new and maybe unique chance to speak and act for Jesus and to again be Christ in the world. Our calling, as ever, is to proclaim the kingdom of God and to pray and act to change the world, beginning with ourselves. As I record this, all is quiet in this peaceful garden. But yesterday the wind was howling through it and disturbing the trees and the whole scene. We need the wind of the Spirit to blow us back out into the world, renewed and refreshed with the gospel. We certainly must not get back to normal, whatever that normal was. There's one more key question that comes in Acts chapter 2 later on, after Peter has spoken of the risen Christ, and people's hearts begin to open by the Spirit. The question, very simply, is, what shall we do? Listen to verse 27 on. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and for your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." The task of God's church, then, as we emerge, the task of your church is to help people answer that question. And of course, the heart of the answer is there in the passage in Peter's words. Repent and be baptized. Have a change of mind, a change of heart. Turn your life around towards God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Come with us on the journey. We'll be alongside you and help you. And I leave you with one more very practical question. How are you? How am I? How are we going to do just that? A prayer to close. Holy Spirit, sent by the Father, ignite in us your holy fire. Strengthen your children with the gift of faith. Revive your church with the breath of love. And renew the face of the earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Blessed assurance. everyone at St Paul's and St Mary's. It's so good to be able to talk to you today. And I'd just like to share one of the things I've been doing while I've been in lockdown. It all started at the beginning of it when somebody put on Facebook that they're like hearts knitted. And the idea behind that is we'd knit two hearts the same and put them into a bag and they'd go up to the hospital. And what would happen with those is the one would go with one of the patients and the other would go home with a relative. And the idea behind that is the two hearts would be united as one when they return home. And sadly, if they'd lost somebody, one heart would be laid in the coffin and the other would go home and stop with the family. So they've got a constant reminder of the loved one, and somebody, one of the staff or the funeral directors, place that in the heart, in the coffin, so that they have that with them and be united that way. Sometimes it made me very sad to think of that, but also give me great joy when you read on Facebook some of the things the family's put and how they found that helpful. I then went up to Keyfields and was told that the families were missing their loved ones and weren't able to visit, so I did knit a set for Keyfields. That's the care home that we, Barbara and I, work at and volunteer at. And one stopped with the resident and the other's gone home to their families. One night, I got up about 3 o'clock in the morning. I finished all that, but still had loads of wool left. And I said to God, what could I do with that wool? And he said, share it with your church family. So that's exactly what I've done. And the idea about that, each and every one of you will be receiving one of these hearts. And the idea is you keep that at home and hold on to that. And as you hold on to that, you think of your church family, each and every one of them. And then when we return back with a joyful praise to the Lord, we will bring all the hearts back into our churches at St Paul's and at St Mary's and unite all the church hearts together. So once again, we're united as one. But this is to remind us, we're not in a church, but we are still one body in Christ. We are one body in Christ, and hopefully this will help unite us as one, remind us that we are one body in Christ, even though we're not in the building. God be with you, and thanks be to God.
Good morning, this wonderful Pentecost Sunday. The reading today is from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 23. And I'm reading from the Good News Bible, from the New Testament, John chapter 20, verses 19 to 23. Jesus appears to his disciples. It was late that Sunday evening and the disciples were gathered together behind locked doors because they was afraid of the Jewish authorities. Then Jesus came and stood amongst them. Peace be with you, he said. After saying this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy at seeing the Lord. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. Then he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven. Praise be to God.
Romans 8, verse 18 to 25, the future glory. I consider that what we suffer at this present time cannot be compared at all with the glory that is going to be revealed to us. All of creation waits with eager longing for God to reveal his sons. For creation was condemned to lose its purpose, not of its own will, but because God willed it to be so. Yet there was hope that creation itself would one day be set free from its slavery to decay and would share the glorious freedom of the children of God. For we know that up to the present time, all of creation groans with pain, like the pain of childbirth. But it is not just creation alone which groans. We who have the Spirit as the first of God's gifts also groan with ourselves. As we wait for God to make us his sons and set our whole being free. For it was by hope that we were saved. that if we see what we hope for, then it is not really hope. For who hopes something he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This Pentecost Sunday, here I am in St. Paul's. I really am in St. Paul's. There's no green screen behind me. There is the John Piper image of the risen Christ with his two disciples. And we see Christ, as it were, emerging from the darkness of the tomb. I don't know if that is what John Piper had in mind for the surround to be so dark, but perhaps that was part of his thinking. The resurrection that Christ brings is about new birth. And when a child is born, there is pain and there is struggle. When a caterpillar turns into a butterfly and has to cast off its chrysalis, there is struggle. And in this creation, in this world, as we know so well at the moment, there are the birth pangs of the new creation. But amidst it all, Christ is with us. And just as he transformed the life of those two disciples by his Spirit, he transforms our lives too. So now I'm going to make my way back home, and there I will be able to have a true green screen. May the words of my mouth and the thoughts of all our hearts make sense in your sight, O Lord, our God and our Rescuer. Amen. Well, here I am back home. Where there is a new birth, everything changes. There is no going back to the old normal. Some may try. A father may desert his wife and daughter because he will not face his responsibilities. A mother will find it much harder to do so. But for neither can there be any going back. A child is born. The future is changed. A child does not come into the world without pain and agony. Men may protest that man flu is the most painful thing out there, but no man has any idea of the agony of childbirth, though I did know one mother who seemed to be an exception to the rule. No wonder that the Bible speaks of the agonies and groans of childbirth and parenting as illustrations of what accompanies the new creation that God is bringing about. All creation is groaning, says Paul in our Romans reading. And in writing these words, he was echoing the words of the prophet Isaiah, who hundreds of years earlier puts these words in the mouth of God. The mouth of God himself. For a long time I have held my peace. I have kept still and restrained myself. Now I will cry out like a woman in labour. I will gasp and pant. I will lay waste mountains and hills and dry up all their herbage. The new and the coming of the new is never cosy. It arrives through struggle that turns into birth, though along the way the struggle might be mistaken for death pangs. Newness is not easy for God. Newness is not easy for creation that is too long in the grip of death. Newness is not easy for you and me. It is a process of pain that is deep, so deep that it cannot be lived through quietly. We cry out with groans. And it is not just the pain of giving birth. It is the pain of mum and dad settling into their new relationship. It is the pain of having to learn to prefer the other. It is the pain of not getting your own way. And then when a child is born, it is the agonies of worry, the nights without sleep, the worries and anxieties that begin at the moment of birth and never stop throughout life. Paul says that all of creation shares in this childbirth, these agonies and groans. There are the disasters that hit our world. There are the inward agonies as we struggle with whatever the day brings. This is the stuff of life, and the Psalms are full of such agonizing prayers. We heard earlier from Psalm 4, and it begins, "Answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief for my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer." And I guess that all of us will have shared in prayers like that, perhaps as agonizing alongside a patient we are caring for, perhaps with those grieving for someone who has died, perhaps when we were in mental distress aggravated by lockdown, or wondering when we are going to see family again, or being wrecked with anxiety because we do not know if we will have a job or if our business will survive. As Bishop Peter reminded us, God does not give us a bridge over troubled waters, but a pathway through it. God hears all of our groans. He heard the groans of the children of Israel when they were slaves in Egypt. The story of their rescue from Egypt and the journey through the Red Sea begins with the groans of the Israelites. When Jonah was in the large fish, he cried out to God, and God heard his cry and delivered him. When the Israelites were in exile in Babylon, they cried out to God, and so close was God to them that he himself groaned, as we heard earlier. I'll read those verses again. "For a long time," God says, "I have held my peace. I have kept still and restrained myself. Now I will cry out like a woman in labour. I will gasp and pant. I will lay waste mountains and hills and dry up all their herbage." This is amazing. God himself groans. He enters into the new birth with us. And this we see on the cross. Jesus shared in the cry of all creation when he called out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" The groans you and I feel are felt by God himself. The groanings, the anxiety, the worry, the exhaustion, the love. God shares these alongside and with you and me. And this is how the judgment is overcome. God in Christ no longer stands over us, but comes alongside us. He knows that only with him, with us, can we go through the valley of the shadow of death. But that valley, as we trust in Christ, becomes the birth canal to the new creation. For us, the new creation of a life that never ends, and in due course, a new heaven and a new earth. Together, God with us brings his new creation to birth. God's new creation is not without struggle. It does not come automatically. It is not the sort of gift that simply lands on our laps. We are not evolving towards it. For us, it includes the struggles, the facing up to the reality that the old ways of life, the old hopes, the old longings, the old normal will no longer do. But we await something that is far better, and we groan and long and work towards it. And this is so much of what praying is about as we watch and pray, so that we are part of God bringing in his new creation. And God's Spirit prays within us, as Paul says, with groans that we do not understand, but the Spirit of God knows. In this pandemic, we are shocked and bewildered, and we want to blame someone, but no one has the answers. We groan, governments groan. Some may deny things, others may despair. But for those who have eyes to see, there is the new creation coming back, a new birth. There is no way back, for God is at work, calling us on to the true normal, the new normal. This is what Pentecost is about. God's Spirit is poured out on all flesh and is working in all of creation, in you and me and all creation. And as we groan and long, this is part of our praying and part of God bringing in that new creation. And we pray with yearnings that we cannot turn into words. But we will come through this. We will get through this not with mere optimism, not with what some call the power of positive thinking, but in the struggles and with hope, especially in prayer as we watch and pray, and as we open ourselves out to the Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the grave. That Spirit that pulled Jesus out of the grave, as it were, pulls us forward into the new heaven and the new earth and gives us hope, trust and faith. Let us not deny the reality of all that is happening. Let us not despair because we hold on to the old. Yes, we can grieve it, but let us welcome and embrace the struggles of childbirth that God's Spirit leads into. And after we have gone through our Good Friday, there is Easter Sunday. Amen.
Almighty Father God, you promise to hear those who pray in faith. You are stronger and mightier than all powers. You are the Lord, the Mighty One, the Holy One of Israel. So hear us now as we bow before your eternal throne of grace. On this Pentecost Sunday, come Holy Spirit, help us, teach us, guide us in your ways of truth and peace. Heavenly Father, we pray for your church in the world, for our brothers and sisters in Christ. Help us be aware of the suffering of those persecuted and marginalized in so many countries. We pray for all Christians working in hostile environments, and especially those who are trying to bring help and comfort to those suffering from the coronavirus in poor countries with limited or little medical help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Our loving Lord, we pray for your world you created in perfect harmony. Please forgive us when we spoil the balance of nature and cause so much destruction. We pray for those countries without enough food, where starvation is real, while we in the West waste so much. Thank you that we are now realising the importance of our ecosystems, and recently, through lockdown, appreciating nature so much more. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we pray for our Queen, the Royal Family, the Prime Minister, and all serving in government, both nationally and locally. We pray for wisdom, understanding, and correct decisions in these difficult and challenging times. In your mercy, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, as we celebrate today the coming of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, filling the believers with your assurance to go out and witness to the world of your sacrifice and your love. We pray for all churches in our town, whatever the denomination, that we may be the means of drawing people to the love and compassion of Jesus. Please fill us and your whole church with the spirit of love, service, and peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for our local community, for our loved ones, especially those who don't yet know you as Lord. In these unprecedented times, we pray for the lonely, the vulnerable, and those who rely on the Maybury and other drop-in centres, now closed. We ask for your compassion on the users of the food bank and the homeless. We pray for, before you, Lord, all those charities we support in our churches who are struggling from the lack of donations. We pray especially for Portia Yadam of Crosslinks in the UK at present, who can't return to her work. She can't return to Ghana because of the restrictions on travel, and therefore can't help her students, the youth and children's leaders. So Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind or spirit. Those who suffer with anxiety and mental health in these difficult times. And especially those who mourn. Those who are bereaved, who cannot say goodbye to their loved ones as they would wish. And in a moment of silence, bring them before the Lord now. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. So rejoicing in the fellowship of all your saints, we commend ourselves and the whole creation to your unfailing love. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous things. Blessed be his glorious name for ever. May his glory fill the whole earth. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.